May we pray together for a moment. Oh, gracious God, as we still listen to the music in our ears, we ask that you would be with us in this time of worship, that we take in all that is happening, from Charlotte's baptism to Chris's music to the words of Scripture, and help us to wrestle with all these ideas and images. And as we hear your word, may we listen for your Spirit in our lives. In Christ Jesus we pray. Amen. Rachel's also already given us a beginning, a running of the story for today. It is the parable of the prodigal son, in which I'll be preaching from this week and next week. And we'll split the parable in two halves, basically in the way that Jesus taught it. He taught it as a two-part story. So, from the first half, the 15th chapter of Luke, beginning with verse 11. Then Jesus said, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of my property that will belong to me.' So he divided his property between them. A few days later, the younger son gathered all that he had and traveled to a distant country. And there he squandered his property in desolate living. When he had spent everything, a severe famine took hold throughout that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He would gladly have filled himself with the pods that the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired hands have bread enough and to spare, and here I am dying of hunger? I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands.' So he went off and went to his father, and while he was still far away, his father saw him and was filled with compassion, and he ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. Then the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his slaves and servants, 'Quickly bring out a robe, the best one, and put it on him, and put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet, and get the fatted calf and kill it. And let us eat and celebrate, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they began to celebrate." Here ends the reading of God's holy word. May God bless it for our hearing and understanding. When reading the parable of the prodigal son, we see firsthand evidence of Jesus as a master storyteller. A man has two sons. With that single, simple sentence, he is already having us assuming sibling rivalry. Why else do you begin a story? A man has two sons, not one son, but two. And any of us who have been touched by sibling rivalry, either in pain or with rewards, are already tapped into the story and recalling our own stories between our siblings. And Jesus does not disappoint with the second sentence, which says something like this: "Dad, I'm sick of living here with you and my stinking brother. I wish you were dead. So why don't you just give me my inheritance now, and I'm out of here." I mean, with a beginning like that, who can't sit up and listen, right? And amazingly, the father does not take offense. He doesn't throw him out of the house and his clothes on the street. It's the first plot twist in the story. Instead, the father cashes in his investment account, sells a couple of hard assets, and gives his son half of everything he had, what would be the son's inheritance one day. All this to the dismay of the older brother. The young man predictably heads for the far country. Why say, "I wish you were dead, Dad," if you're not going to go far away? Why get away as far as you can? Where he lives it up for some time in desolate living. He's throwing big parties, in other words, spending a lot of cash, buying some friends. And he burns through the money fast. Before long, we do not know how long, a year, 2 years, 5 years, he runs through the money, runs through all the inheritance, his father's life's work. And then a famine occurs. He was too busy living it up to finish college, and since he wasn't from around here, nobody is hiring him for a decent job. The best he can do is a demeaning job for a Jewish boy, feeding the pigs, animals his religion wouldn't even let him eat. He is so hungry, so poor, so desperate, he wished at times to eat the food he was giving the pigs. He had reached the bottom. But at this point, a miracle happens in the story. Jesus says that he came to himself. We might say he looked at himself in the mirror and didn't like what he saw. The whole story turns on that sentence. It pivots the parable. Like an alcoholic or an addict, it took bottoming out before he realized what his life had become, and he was determined to change it. In looking in the mirror, he realizes that he was worse off than even the unskilled laborers on his father's ranch. His awareness was at least twofold, if not three. He looked inside of himself. He looked at the time of life in which he was. And he looked at all that was happening around him. He critically assessed his reality. He decides to go home. The place that he had ran away from in the first place. But he is not going to return as a favored son. Humbled, he will simply ask his father, "Will you let me work on the ranch as one of your hired hands?" So important is his awareness and his humble solution that this sentence is repeated twice in the story. This sentence in which he's going to pitch his father to be a hired hand on the farm takes 15% of the story by itself. Just that sentence. Personal awareness is the key to transformation. And Jesus makes it the pivot point in this most famous of his parables. How can we learn the wisdom of the prodigal? Hopefully, before we bottom out. How can we learn the wisdom of the prodigal son and cultivate awareness into our life and into our faith? One of the first habits we need to get into if we're going to cultivate awareness in our life is to develop a faithful skepticism. Now, I don't mean just being skeptics and being cynical about everything. We've got too many curmudgeons as we have. We don't need any more around us. but a faithful skepticism. One that keeps us looking for God in the midst of what's going on around us. I mentioned this briefly a couple months ago in my sermon on sermons, in which I told you not to swallow any of my sermons whole, or for that matter, any preacher's. Don't swallow a sermon like you might swallow a communion wafer. Sermons, I said, are meant to be chewed on, to work around in your mouth, to think about it, to reflect upon it, at least the rest of the service, maybe for the whole day, possibly for the week. How I wrestle with a sermon text, a scripture passage, may or not be how you should wrestle with it. But in sharing with you how I'm wrestling and reading this text, this Word of God to us, I'm inviting you to wrestle beside me in your own way. 1 John chapter 4, verse 1 says, "Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God." This is what we should do with all information. Test what you are watching, listening to, reading, to see if God is in it and where. We cannot, for instance, accept traditional or online or social media at face value. The job of the talking heads on ESPN or Fox News or MSNBC or CNN or even the Weather Channel. Their job is to keep us watching. So they're going to raise up fear and going to raise up controversy to get us agitated so we're going to watch a little bit more. I'm always fascinated by the Weather Channel when a storm comes. It is always the storm of the century, right? And you better stay riveted by your television set so you every single moment so you can avoid it, right? This sense of fear, well, that sense is in ESPN when they're talking about your favorite ball teams or any news channel. Just to keep you watching. Faithful skepticism invites us, encourages us to ask, why are they telling me this? And why are these two talking heads yelling at each other? Do they want me to yell at somebody else? And if so, why? We are bombarded with information 24/7 in this information 21st century world. And we have to be faithfully skeptical about all of it. Remember last week, simple illustration, last week in my sermon, I quoted a passage that I had seen several months before, and I say this, that I'm going to use that sometime in a sermon. Comparison is the thief of joy, I said, which supposedly was by Teddy Roosevelt. But as I began trying to define the source so that I could then share it with you as a congregation, another phrase popped up. Comparison is the death of joy by Mark Twain. So I began looking for that one as well. After over 2 hours, I could not find any proof that either of those guys had said those phrases. That's kind of how it works with information. Now, maybe one of them said that. If one of you all find out, please let me know so I can mark it for future sermons. More likely, some non-famous person said that phrase. It passed on. Somebody else said, well, who said that? They said, well, it sounds like Teddy Roosevelt or it sounds like Mark Twain. And there you go. And if you look it up on the internet, it's all over the place, except nobody says where they said it. So, before we swallow the news or the social media thread or rumors around the church or any other information somebody gives you, even a preacher's sermon, chew on it for a while. We should be asking at least 3 questions with every bit of information. What's the source of this information? What evidence is this person sharing to verify this information? And why are they telling me this? Who, what, why? In order to operate in this information age, we all have to be about that, so that we can find if God is in this, and if so, where? In the parable, the prodigal son makes a change when he assesses his situation with the hired, compares it to the hired hands on his father's farm. He had firsthand knowledge of his father's integrity. He had firsthand knowledge of how his father's employees were treated. And he realized he was worse off than they were. And he determined it was time to go home, not as a son, but as a hired hand on his father's farm. Understand, of course, the prodigal son had to learn this the hard way. At first, he believed that if he could just run away from home and live his life free, he would find his life. Then he believed that if he spent a lot of money, he would draw all sorts of friends to him, friends for life. And then he believed that when he fell on hard times, all of those friends that he had met that way would take care of him. Wrong, wrong, wrong. Thankfully, he learned through those hard lessons. He became aware of what he had lost. And he decided to change his life. Only when we learn the hard way sometimes, like the prodigal son, do we learn to have a faithful skepticism about life. The second thing I think we need to cultivate, if we're going to cultivate awareness in our life, is to understand that life comes us in seasons. We see the seasons. Like right now, it is summertime, folks. If anybody had any doubt about that, you know it by being in this sanctuary, right? It is summertime. Life comes from winter, spring, summer, fall, and the cycle returns. One of the things we have to ask ourselves from time to time is, what season of life am I in? My son just took a big job, a big new job, a big scary job. He's 25 years old. He might be way over his head with this new job. But as he was talking about this with my wife and me, he said, Michael, when are you else going to take a chance like this, right? You're 25. It's the spring of your life. Go ahead and take this big jump. If it fails, you've got plenty of time to try something else. But this is a big, bold thing you can do now. In the spring of your life, it's the time to do it. Now, taking this chance might not have been good if he was my age and trying to figure out how to work towards retirement. But he's not. He's in the spring of his life. Are you aware of kind of what time is it? What season is it in your life? Sometimes you have to be aware also the seasons of the lives of the people around you. I received a text a few weeks ago. I've never had to use this before, but comes in handy today. Received a text a few weeks ago from someone I knew pretty well, and they were just biting my head off. They were so angry at me. I was looking at the text to figure out what I had said. Was not apparent. So I kind of just trying to joke back a little bit and said, whoa, what's going on? I don't think I messed up your Wheaties today. Can we talk? Not text. Can we talk? Came to find out he had just gotten chewed out by his boss, wondering if he would be fired before too long. And all that anxiety and that fear just came up when he took something wrong in this text thread we were working on. Now, if I had taken offense, as I easily could have, and jumped right back in and said, what are you calling me that for? Everything would have escalated. But I took a moment to listen, and I heard the season that was going on in his life. scared about his job, wondering if his boss is going to fire him. All that anxiety was in him, and it came out on me. Had nothing to do with me. Everything to do with the season of his life. One of the things that operating in relationships is we need to be aware of what's going on in our lives and what's going on in the lives of the people around us. What season is it for them? The prodigal son realized he was still young enough to start over again. So he took this risk and went back home to his father. The third thing that we need to cultivate is an awareness of ourselves within ourselves. At the beginning of the parable, the prodigal son thought that the thing he wanted most in life was just to be free from home. Only if he could be out of the control of his father and his stinking brother, then he could be free to be the person he was meant to be. So he left home with his inheritance money to a distant country. The problem, however, with trying to find yourself by running away is that we always end up running in the opposite direction, which is always reacting to whatever we think is going on. You know, there's a pop psychology joke that says that sooner or later we all become just like our parents, which you may have seen in some Geico commercials, or we become the opposite of our parents, right? That either we follow them, we're just like them, or we say we run away and go the opposite way. The prodigal son did exactly what rebellious children always do. He ran to the far country, as far from home as he possibly could. Now he could be free to be himself. Or was he? Unaware of himself, he simply becomes a caricature, a predictable, rebellious child who wants to be the opposite of mom or dad. There's an old Jewish tale from the Middle Ages about a rabbi named Zuza. One night, God comes to Zuza in a dream. God asked him, "Zuza, what are you doing with your life?" Zuza apologizes for not leading his people like Moses had led the Israelites. God said, "I did not ask you why you're not Moses." Rabbi Zuza then apologized for not being as faithful as Daniel was in the face of persecution. God said, "I did not ask you why you were not Daniel." The rabbi then asked God, "Well, then what is it you want me to do?" God replied, "I want to know why you have not been Zuza." None of us are free to be whatever we want to be. We all have these bodies. We have the DNAs our parents and grandparents gave us. We have these limitations upon us. None of us are free to be whatever we want to be. But we are free to be ourselves. And we can only be ourselves when we are aware of what's going on inside of us. That's what the prodigal son realized as he stood in the muck and the mud of the pig pen and wished he could eat the pig slop. But rather than fight who he was, rather than run any longer from who he was, he came to himself and he went back home. "I'm not free to be whoever I want to be. But I am free to be me, truly me." Parker Palmer, the Quaker theologian and educator, describes our souls like wild animals. "If you want to see a wild animal," he says, "you have to be very still and wait. If you're wandering in the woods, just stop, take a seat, and watch. Maybe you catch a glimpse of something. So you sit 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes. And then the mother deer and her doe walk right past you. Or maybe a moose pops through some trees and starts going into the pond that's between you and the moose and begins swimming all the way under, like a baptism underwater, cooling off in the summer heat. And as the moose pops up, the water drips like waterfalls off his antlers. Or maybe it's a small bird that you could hear but you couldn't see, and so you just stand, and closer you hear the song until you finally see it. A small bird, shiny brown feathers and a bright white belly. Phoebe, 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 it calls. And you later find out it's called the Eastern Phoebe because of its call. All these moments came at different moments when my family and I were hiking national parks and woods. We watched the moose for 45 minutes. Parker Palmer says, that's how our souls are. If you want to see our souls, if you want to be aware of what God is doing deep within us, we have to be still. Just like you do to see the doe and her mother deer, or the moose, or the bird. In our 24/7 world, we rarely have moments where we just stop and listen, stop and reflect. Sometimes we're so afraid of what our minds do when we stop, that as soon as we have a free moment, as soon as nothing has happened, we have to whip out our phones and begin putting more information in our minds. If you're going to be aware of what's going on in your life, if you're going to be aware of what God is doing deep within your soul, you've got to stop every now and then and just listen and be still. Letty Russell, one of the first major female theologians of the 20th century and a professor at Yale Divinity School, in her book Becoming Human, wrote that our strengths and our sins are oftentimes the same opposite sides of the same coin. And if we're not listening to ourselves, if we're not aware of ourselves, we can be pushing on our strengths and not realizing our sins and our problems are building up. The personality trait that gives you most vibrancy, that brings you acclaim and achievement, also may give you traits that get you in trouble. The charismatic personality that attracts multitudes of people may find forming deep relationships difficult. The strong leader may become too dominant and leave others' opinions out and soon builds up resentment around him. Great students and great minds can get so deep in their books that they have problems relating to people on a more fun level. Wonderfully kind and emotionally warm people might struggle making decisions based on rational or logical thinking because they rely so much on their intuition. Some of the things we see as problems in our lives may just be the flip side of our strengths. Sometimes the greatest inspirations in life come to us at our lowest moments. Times when we, like the prodigal son, come to ourselves. Times when we realize the mess that we've caused may just be our misapplied strengths. Accepting who you are and accepting how God has made you can allow us to live as we are, not as people are prodding us to be. Accepting who you are, accepting how God has made you, is the key to transformation. Frederick Buechner, my favorite author, was traumatized at age 12 when his father committed suicide. In his young childhood mind, he saw that in his mind that his father had abandoned him. He didn't have the ability to see how depressed and alone his father was. But in his mind, his father had abandoned him. And this caused great problems the rest of his life in building relationships because he always wanted to smother the people he loved because he was so afraid they would abandon him too. But the smothering of them oftentimes made them want to push him away. It wasn't until he was finally able to say, I'm not 12 years old anymore. I can relate to people differently. And this person I'm trying to smother to hold tight, she is not my father. She will not abandon me like I felt he did. Once he got into his story and understood his pain, then he could begin relating to people in different ways. To improve relationships, sometimes we have to dig deep into our own history. Isn't this what the prodigal son did for himself, realizing that his father's servants were better than he was standing in this pig pen? In the scene you remember most of the story, when the father runs out to his son and gives him a big bear hug and knocks him down and tells the servants, quick, get a band, get a party, let's have a feast. The son begins repeating what he had rehearsed. Father, I'm no longer worthy to be your son. Treat me as your hired hand. And the father pays it no attention. But the thing is, we don't know what happens at the end of the story. We don't know if the son goes on to insist to be a hired worker or if he goes back in the role of a son. I'd like to imagine maybe they had a compromise. The prodigal son got to live like a son again, but now he was like the foreman on the farm, overseeing the field hands or something like that. I'd like to imagine the prodigal saying to his father, I want to be free to be me. And I imagine the father saying, yes, you are. You always have been. That's why I created you the way you are. So you can be free to be you. Amen.